Well, here we are with the first of our groups on this, the last day of crafts. We haven't, sadly, got a full complement of the terriers at the moment. We hope that the others may well be able to join us. In the meantime, Mr. Andrew Thompson is taking his first look at these best of breed winners from throughout the terrier group. When he's seen them all and examined them individually and moved them, he's going to cut from the 24 dogs, which is the full group, to 6 or possibly even 8. And from those, he will, of course, make his final selection of the 4, the group winner, and those placed 2, 3, and 4 behind the winner. See, the miniature bull terrier has just come in. It's one which was missing. And so Mr. Thompson comes to his first breed, the Airedale Terrier. Judged today by Mr. George Dale, from an entry of 90, he picked number 14742 as his best of breed. And it is reputed that the Airedale Agricultural Show gave the Airedale its name. Many waterside terriers, as they were called, made up a large entry at this show. Sporting Yorkshiremen used Airedales in their crosses to go after foxes, weasels, otters, badger, water rats, and small game in the valleys where run the rivers Calder, Wharfe, and Aire. This is the background to the Airedale Terrier. Classes first put on for these dogs in 1879. The Airedale actually has remarkable scenting powers, has been used to track large game in Africa, India, Canada, and the US. This, ladies and gentlemen, your Airedale Terrier 14742. On the table, we have the Australian Terrier, judged today by Mrs. Brenda Brown. She had a You may know that there are 2 native Australian Terrier breeds which are tied into each other and yet are distinct. We have one in the toy group, the Australian Silky Terrier, and one in the Terrier. That is the one we're now looking at, the Australian Terrier. Both were developed in the 19th century by Australians using native British Terrier breeds. The likely emergence of the Australian Terrier, this one, was from Scottish and Northern England terriers taken to Australia by settlers. Gained British approval as a show dog in 1936. This then, the Australian 14821. And now we come to the Border Terrier, judged today by Mr. Brian Staveley, from an entry of 199, he chose this one, 14970. These rough, wiry dogs hail from the rugged border country between England and Scotland. And the requirement of the breed is for legs long enough to be able to move swiftly across the countryside, to follow a horse if needs be, and yet still be small enough to go to ground. It was once known as the Reed Water Terrier, or the Cockettdale Terrier, after the valleys and localities of the breed's early existence. The present name came about in 1880, most likely because he was commonly worked with the border foxhounds. The breed was accepted by the Kennel Club in 1920. This then the Border Terrier 14970. Here we have the Bull Terrier, a breed which we're told came originally from crosses of the bull baiting dogs and the former English White Terrier with a bit of Dalmatian thrown in. Bull Terriers were judged by Miss Phyllis McCombie. She had an entry of 103. This is her best of breed, 15158. The breed was first standardized in the 1850s by James Hinks, selecting the egg-shaped head, white color, though after type was fixed, color variety was also allowed. This breed was first shown in its present form in Birmingham in 1862. It's not unusual to see handlers in the breed wearing the white stockman's coat. This is the Bull Terrier 15158. And now we come to the miniature Bull Terrier, also judged by Miss Phyllis McCombie. 31 of these came under her. The number of this is 15235. Miniature Bull Terriers were bred primarily to help their larger namesake in rat killing duties, and they were great favorites with those who fancied the breed as a house pet. At one time, miniature Bull Terriers weighed from as little as 3 pounds to 30 pounds. But the variety of under 10 pounds for which there were classes at the Islington Show in London in 1863 virtually disappeared because of problems connected with extreme miniaturization. Miniature Bull Terrier Club was founded in 1938. They became eligible for KC Challenge certificates shortly afterwards. Miniature Bull Terrier 15235. Here we have the Cairn Terrier, judged as a breed by Miss Sally Ogle, with a good entry of 165. Her best of breed was 15252. It was in 1909 that Mrs. Alistair Campbell exhibited the dog of this breed for the first time. It's putting it mildly, I think, to say that it caused a few rumbles. Yet, within 3 years, the Kennel Club recognized the breed and its challenge certificates were on offer. A native dog of the Western Highlands of Scotland, the Isle of Skye and parts of the Hebrides. Files of rock were used to mark a grave or a boundary in these places, and these cairns, as they were called, became hiding places and homes for foxes and vermin. The small game terrier was needed to seek them out. That's where the cairn gets its name. History of the breed goes back something like 500 years. This then, our Cairn Terrier 1525. Now we come to the Dandie Dinmont. Its breed, number here is 15427. The breed was judged today by Mrs. Frances Chapman King, and she had an entry of 84. And this is a breed developed as a specialist for otter and badger hunting way back in the 1600s. It comes from the same stock as many others from the north of England and the border country between England and Scotland. Crosses involving a number of breeds are suggested in his very appearance, both of hounds and of running dogs. Body should be long, Somewhere I read the body is thought of as about an inch or two shorter than twice the height, if you can work that out. This then, the Dandy Dinmont 15427. Here we have the first of the fox terriers which were being shown today. This is the wire hair version, judged by Mrs. Pat Taylor. She had an entry of 58, her best of breed 15571. The fox terrier in both its forms, the wire and the smooth, is known worldwide, but is a breed which is produced in Britain. It's likely that originally it came from the same types of dog which produced both the bull terrier and the smooth black and tan, or Manchester terrier. But there would have been many additions, including probably scent and sighting hounds, to bring it to the sort of breed we now know. Uniformity of type for this breed was established in the late 1800s. The original standard was drawn up in 1876. The wire should have a short back, level and strong, and a dense wiry coat. Wire head, wire fox terrier, 15571. And here we have now on the table the smooth. And smooth fox terriers were judged by Mrs. Gwen Kempster. She had an entry of 63, her best of breed 15523. The smooth should also be short-backed, level and strong, with a straight, flat, smooth, hard and dense and abundant coat. And the standard says the underside should not be bare. It's interesting to compare the standards of the two, which, although they vary in the way the words are expressed, show not too much variation in content apart from coat detail. It's likely that the rough coat was developed before the smooth, but the wire made its show ring debut some 20 years after the smooth. And this is the smooth, best of breed today. It's number 15523. This is the Glenavimal, judged as a breed today by Mrs. Ferelith Summerfield. From an entry of 23, she chose 15625 as her best of breed. This breed hails from County Wicklow in the Irish Republic. Folklore says the breed was the result of crossing a mongoose with a Celtic hound, and the offspring was saved from culling by St. Patrick. St. Patrick's Day today. There are many other stories in the early days of the breed, including one which had helped St. Patrick rid the countryside of snakes. More likely, and much more likely, is that this is an old breed for long ignored by the dog fancy, as were a number of other Irish breeds. Glens were used for a number of things, to go to ground for badger and fox and keep down the rat population on the farms. Glenavimal, ladies and gentlemen, 15625. Now we come to the Irish Terrier, judged today by Mrs. Monica Roger Black. She had an entry of 44. This one is number 15645. Called at one time the Irish Red Terrier. That was in order to distinguish it from other terriers in Ireland. This may well be the oldest of all of them, for dogs like these have been known for hundreds of years. It's very terrier-like in its active and lively approach to life. Should appear gracefully racy in outline, standing 19 inches in the dog and 18 in the bitch. The Irish Terrier was once seen in black and tan or brindle as well as red. And it was once used for dog fighting, and the breed's jaws were certain death to any rat it came across. Yet the breed could also wear another hat, that of a soft mouth retriever. The breed first shown in Ireland in 1875. This then, the Irish Terrier, 15645. Here we have the Kerry Blue, a breed whose origins seem somewhat obscure, yet which became the mascot for the Irish Patriots. Kerry Blues were judged by Mr. Don Munro. From an entry of 55, he chose this one, 15701. Born black, these dogs turn to any shade of blue and can have or not. On the table, the Lakeland Terrier. Lakelands were judged by Mr. A.B. Johnston. He had an entry of 37, and his best of breed is 15757. The northwest of England, which houses the Lake District, has been the home of many fine terriers whose background has been hunting. The breed we now call the Lakeland has been linked with the Old English Black and Tan, as have several other breeds. Strains of terrier became known from the area where they originated, Patterdale, Belted Water, or Fell Terrier, but all were Lakelands insofar as they emanated from the general area of the lakes. But they weren't known as the Lakeland until a club was formed in 1912. The breed was formally recognised by the Kennel Club in 1921. 10 years later, Kennel Club challenge certificates were on offer. Dogs go about 17 pounds, bitches 2 pounds less. Height not to exceed 14 and a half inches. This then, the Lakeland Terrier 15757. Here we have the Manchester Terrier. Unlike the English Toy Terrier, the Manchester owes its origins to the Black and Tan Terriers, believed to have been the original Ratting Terrier and highly skilled in its job. Manchesters were judged today by Miss Alison Anderson. She had an entry of 69. Her best of breed, 15799. The sport in which these dogs engaged, albeit that of the poorer classes, was rat killing and rabbit coursing. And it reached its peak in about the mid-1800s in the Manchester area. There was a need to create a dog with grit for both purposes, and a black and tan was crossed with a coursing whippet. And from this crossing, they developed the breed we now call the Manchester Terrier, standing up to 16 inches in the dogs, 15 in the bitches. This then, ladies and gentlemen, is your Manchester Terrier best of breed, 15799. Norfolk Terriers. Norfolks were judged today by Mrs. Eileen Needham. She had an entry of 78, and this one is number 15886. Norfolks and Norwich have a close affinity, and ancestors of these breeds are thought to have been some of those tough little dogs which also produced the Border Terrier and the Cairn. Two breeds take their names, obviously, from the county of Norfolk and the city of Norwich. Though turning the clock back 150 years or so, there was no official recognition of the Norfolk stroke Norwich, which was then just another general farm dog. This one is what we call the Norfolk Terrier. It's number 15886. Now the Norwich, judged by Mr. Roger Thomas. He had an entry of 49. 15964 was his best of breed. And this mix of Norfolk stroke Norwich Terriers, about 100 years ago, these little terriers became all the rage with Cambridge University undergraduates, so much so, as written, that there were some who felt he should be called the Cantab Terrier to honour the place which promoted him. In the early 1900s, there was a Keystone sire called Rags, and one prominent breeder in the early part of this century was a horseman called Frank Jones, a nicknamed Rough Rider, who had Glenavon Mells, and a dark red Cairn-type bitch, some of whom were mated to Rags, as also was another bitch called 90, a Dandy Dinmont stock. harsh-coated red progeny were retained, and they formed the foundation of both the Norfolk and the Norwich. You probably spotted the differences in the ear carriage. The Norfolk is down and the Norwich is up. This then is the Norwich 15964. On the table now we have the Scottish Terrier, judged today by Miss D. Blackstone. She had an entry of 84. She chose as her best of breed 16083. Scottish Terrier Club was formed in 1882, a year after the first standard for the breed was drawn up, and just 3 years after the start of the breed as we now know it, by Captain Gordon Murray. Captain Murray was supported in his work by a man closely associated with both Birmingham and the Kennel Club, Mr. Sir Wallace Evelyn Shirley. He was the first chairman of the Kennel Club and a member of the Birmingham Dog Show Society, which runs the famed national show in May of each year. It's a bit strange that there was no mention of the breed which was to become the Scottish Terrier until 1859. And yet in that year, Scotties were seen as a pure breed, though for a time they were dubbed the Aberdeen Terrier. One of the personalities of Home the Scottie was the former American President Franklin D. Roosevelt. This then, ladies and gentlemen, Scottish Terrier 16083. Now we have the Sealyham Terrier. There were 50 dogs entered under the breed judge, Mrs. Maureen Micklethwaite, who chose 16183 as her best of breed. And it was Captain John Owen Tucker Edwards of a place called Sealyham in Pembrokeshire, South Wales, who decided to promote his idea of the perfect terrier something like 150 years ago. It's believed that he began with the Welsh Corgi, mixed it with the Dandy Dinmont, the West Highland, the Bull Terrier, the Wire Fox Terrier, and even the now extinct Old English Terrier. Also read there was a possibility he used even one of the low Basset type hounds from northern France. He culled hard, it was a question of survival of the fittest, and from all the rigorous tests which he put these dogs through, there emerged the Sealyham, first shown in 1903. It's number 16183, ladies and gentlemen. Skye Terrier. The judge was Mr. John Burrows. He had an entry of 63. His best of breed was 16217. A mix of breeding is behind the Skye. It's believed possibly there's the Cairn or Cairn prototypes. This dog was once called the Terrier of the Western Isles, evolving into what we have today on the island of Skye. I have heard of Grey Friars Bobby. He was a Skye who around 1858 took up vigil at his dead master's grave in Grey Friars Churchyard, Edinburgh. Coaxed away from time to time, but always returned to the grave of the former shepherd, where he was fed by people from the city. Skyes are gentle and loyal creatures, and, says one writer, I quote, tuned into their owners. They stand 10 inches, but it's four times that in the 40 inches from the tip of the nose to the tip of the tail. So, ladies and gentlemen, Skye Terrier 16217. Soft-coated Wheaton, one of the terriers native to Ireland. The judge for these was Mrs. Maureen Micklethwaite. She had 88. From which she chose 16283. Origins of this breed go back a long way, and yet it's probably the least well-known of them all, in Ireland anyway, though we see it quite regularly around the British show rings these days. Little appears to have been written about the breed, which has a purported history going back centuries. 1934 before a breed club was formed, and it was not until 1937 that the Irish Kennel Club recognised the soft-coated Wheaton, and it made its debut at the St. Patrick's Show March the 17th in that year, 1937. First time registered in Britain in 1971. The soft-coated Wheaton 16283. Staffordshire Bull Terrier. We had two judges for this breed, which had the top entry in the terrier group of 308. Dogs were judged by Mrs. Nancy Bolton, and the bitches by Mr. Bill McKnight.
That's Q, yeah, that P.
Their choice for best of breed was 16387. Sadly, a lot of unwelcome publicity has surrounded the Staffordshire in recent years, with certain court cases affecting types of dog considered to be dangerous. It's often been suggested they are, in fact, Staffordshires. Now, I suppose this breed has been something of an enigma. It was born out of the rat killing and dog fighting pits, and it was evolved originally for a sport on which people wagered large sums of money. But eventually, the RSPCA secured the banning of pit fighting, and with this came a new future for the Staffordshire, show dog and pet. Ladies and gentlemen, the Staffordshire Bull Terrier 16387. Here we have the Welsh Terrier. Today's Welsh Terrier is probably the most directly descended breed from the old black and tan broken-coated terrier, also called the Old English, used in the formation of many terrier breeds. The Welsh Terriers were judged today by Mr. B. Rogers. He had an entry of 41, and he chose 16674 as his best of breed. Initially, all the different sort of terriers were shown under one classification until 1888, but English owners wanted a type they could call the English Broken Haired, and the Welsh also wanted to lay claim to their own breed. And they won over the Kennel Club with their terrier-like persistence. The Club for the Welsh Terrier was formed in 1885. It has a coat, wiry, hard, close, abundant, black and tan for preference. Height 15.5 inches, weight 20 to 21 pounds. The Welsh Terrier, 16674. On the table we have the West Highland White. Again, tough little dog, standing some 11 inches at the shoulder, coming from the rough-coated terrier stock of Scotland. And Westies today were judged by Mr. Derek Tattersall, himself a winner here at Crofts with one some years ago. He had an entry of 175. His best of breed was 16763. It's used, like other terriers have been, for vermin control, because white stood out against the natural background. And because of this, white terriers have been in use in Scotland for over 300 years. Among people who fostered the breed over the years was the Duke of Argyll, who fostered the breed on his Roseneath estate, and for a while Westies were known as Roseneath Terriers. At the first organised dog shows they appeared as the White Scottish Terrier. In 1904 they were classified as West Highland Whites. Here we have our West Highland White 16763. Pleased to see that the Bedlington has been able to join us, as the Bedlington can boast a longer traceable pedigree than any other terrier. Bedlingtons today were judged by Mrs. Betty Reddington at an entry of 71, and this one's number is 14902. Lamb-like in appearance, the breed was once known as the Rothbury Terrier, hails from the former mining areas of the north. Bred originally from the wire-coated terriers, and most probably Otterhound and Whippet were introduced. One of the forefathers of the breed, called Peachum, is mentioned as both a Bedlington and a Dandie Dinmont. The breed was a favourite with miners for ratting and seeking out badgers, but it could also hunt otter and rabbits. Gradually, fame spread outside the north, and the Nicknish Association started the breed in 1877. The type has changed and improved over the years, and the lovable nature of this breed of terrier has turned it into a companion animal. This then, ladies and gentlemen, is your Bedlington 14902. I think that brings us to the end of the terriers we have with us. Unfortunately, the past Jack Russell judging has not yet finished, and so I doubt it will be able to join us. We're very sorry about that. So now it's Mr. Thompson's task to go around and look at these dogs again, to make sure in his mind what he saw when he had the individual assessment, and to pick out the ones that he thinks he likes. We anticipate he'll probably be picking six, or maybe eight. And from these, he will shortlist to the four, which he will place in the final group positions. That's it, Mr. Thompson has decided. Please say goodbye to them as Mr. Thompson applauds them out. They've done jolly well to get this far. Good dogs, but they didn't quite make the cut. Where we have in fact got 2, 4, 7 dogs. We've got the Airedale, the Cairn, the Wire Fox Terrier, the Irish, the Norfolk, the Scottish, and the Westie. The one. Bar Fox Terrier, 15571. The Irish, 15645. The Scottish, 16083. To introduce to you the person who is to present the trophies tonight. Ladies and gentlemen, will you please welcome a man 60 years in terriers, judges all the terrier breeds, Mr. Harold Wright, being accompanied into the ring by Vice Chairman of Trusts, Miss Sybil Churchill. And it's the Airedale. The Airedale has got it. 14742. And it's the Norfolk in reserve position. Out comes the West Highlands in Group 3. Those two are sparring to see who's going to be fourth. And the Wire Fox area won it. Group 4 goes to the Wire Fox. Now we're going to say goodbye to those who are leaving us. Well done. You did jolly well to make the cut. Thank you too to Mr. Andrew Thompson, our judge for the Terrier Breed. Thank you, Mr. Thompson. Mr. Wright asks him to come over as he makes the token presentation of the rosette to the Airedale, our group winner. See the lovely trophy standing on the groom board, the flowers, and the other things which go to the winner. Now it's a handshake with the group two, the Norfolk. Group three, the West Highland White. And to the fourth place, the Wire Fox Terrier. Thank you, Mr. Wright. Thank you, Mr. Wright. Thank you, Mr. Thompson. I believe that our stewards are going to lead these top dogs in the Terrier group out for photographs. They're actually being led out by Mr. Thompson, Mr. Wright, and Ms. Churchill.
Right in the middle, I...
That's right, ladies and gentlemen, give them a big hand.